गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। नमामि गौड़पादं च शंकरं श्रीसुरेश्वरं स्वामिनं सच्चिदानंदमिन्द्रं तं ज्ञानरूपिणे। ओम नारायण नारायण नारायण। ओके, टुडे इज सुगमा डे, सो वी कंटिन्यू विद दैट सुगमा अध्यासा, द नेचर ऑफ अध्यासा। पूर्व पक्षी हैज ए वन पेक्यूलियर व्यू एंड सिद्धांति इज रेफ्यूटिंग। ओके, सिद्धांति वॉज टेलिंग वेर आर वी एग्जैक्टली, प्रत्येत्येव तु केवलम् नचि तत्र रजतमस्ति। ऐ थिंक वी आर समवेयर हियर। एनी अध्यासा, सिद्धांति सेज अकांड तांडवितम, ऑल दैट इज ओवर। या ಎರಡು ಮೂರು ಸಲ ಓದ್ಬಿಟ್ರೆ ಐ ಫರ್ಗೆಟ್ ವೇರ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸ್ಟಾಪ್ಡ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್। ಓಕೆ, ಇಫ್ ಐ ಡೋಂಟ್ ರೀಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಐ ನೋ ವೇರ್ ಐ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್, ಇಫ್ ಐ ರೀಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಟ್ವೈಸ್ ಐ ಫರ್ಗೆಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಫೆಮಿಲಿಯರ್ ಐ ಥಾಟ್ ಐ ವುಡ್ ಐ ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ ಕವರ್ಡ್ ಇಟ್। ಓಕೆ, ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಸಮ್ವೇರ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಹಿಯರ್। ಶುಕ್ತಿರಜತೋತ್ಪತ್ತೇರೇವ ತಾವದ ಸಿದ್ಧೇ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಅದ ಸೇಮ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪೂರ್ವಪಕ್ಷಿ ಸೇಸ್ that the adhyasa is a padartha, misunderstanding, bhranti, athava adhyasa, all these only mean a wrong thinking, a misunderstanding, an anubhava which is wrong. See, anubhava means jnanam, your anubhava is wrong, there is no vastu. How different it is. Vastu being there, you have an anubhava. In fact, the whole samsara is only this. This we are arguing so much on the example only, because Purvapakshi wants to establish that the snake knowledge, the bhranti of snake, or the any bhranti is not simply knowledge but an object also. Why he is so particular about it? Because when Purvapakshi establishes that a bhranti is not merely a misunderstanding, bhranti is not simply a knowledge but an object also, if he succeeds in establishing that with the help of that example, with the help of that drishtanta, he wants to prove that even this jagat is only a substance. Now Vedanta says even jagat is only a thought. That's why in Avasthatraya Viveka we have discussed and we have been discussing, there is no such a thing called world independent of avastha. World is nothing but avastha. Jagrat prapancha is nothing but jagrat avastha, and avastha is an experience, that's all. Within the experience you think it is an object, that it is an object is also a thought, is also an experience. So jagat or jagrat prapancha is only nothing but jagrat avastha, just as dream prapancha is inseparable from dream avastha. Dream avastha being an experience. When you are free from the experience, dream world disappears. See the difference. Dream world and the dream avastha. Dream avastha is an experience. Then what is dream world? Dream world is also an experience within the dream. If dream world is only a dream avastha, and dream avastha is only an anubhava, is only an experience. See, dream world, dream avastha, dream experience. All these three are one. They are not three. If the dream world is inseparable from dream avastha, because that's how our experience is, and dream avastha experience is only when you are experiencing. When the experience ceases, there is no avastha and the no world. As you wake up, there is no world. If suppose the world was independent of dream avastha, if swapna prapancha was independent of swapna avastha, then even if you don't experience swapna avastha avastha means an experience. So when you cease to experience dream avastha, what happens? If the world was independent of anubhava, when your anubhava of dream ceases, that means when you cease to be a dreamer, when you cease to experience the dream world, what happens? The world should continue, you alone should be disappearing. Your experience ceases, the world should continue. If the world were independent of your experience. See the point. See, when you are seeing the snake, coming to this world example. You mistake rope for a snake in a dim light, in a thin darkness. So when you are mistaken, you see here is a snake. When you run away, or when you close your eyes, that means your experience of snake stops. Then do you say that the snake exists there? when you are not experiencing the snake, does the snake exist there? It means, is the world independent of experience? Is the dream world independent of dream experience? Is the snake independent of the experience of snake? If they were independent, then when you cease to experience it, the world should continue. When you cease to experience the dream world should continue to exist. But that is not the case. Dream world doesn't exist independent of our dream experience. When your dream experience ceases, dream world also ceases, isn't it? Therefore, dream world is not independent of dream experience. Similarly, waking. Waking world is not independent of waking experience. Waking state experience. State is an experience. Waking world is not independent of waking state or waking experience. When the waking experience ceases, there is no waking world, because waking world doesn't exist outside or independent of waking state. The waking world is a world only when it is in the waking. When the waking ceases, the world also ceases, because world doesn't exist apart from the waking state. This is the Vedanta, this is the tatparya of Vedanta, to show that the world is not independent of the state. And the state merges into Brahman, state is discovered as Brahman, then the world is also Brahman alone. This is one stroke, and this is what Vedanta has been teaching. But if you take the world as independently existing independent of the state, even when the state is not there, it should continue. Then the world's reality, the independent existence of the world, becomes a threat to Brahman. It limits Brahman. Brahman is neither free nor non-dual nor independent. Because there is a parallel existence to Brahman, if the world is existing independent of the state, then its existence nobody can deny. Nobody can remove it. If that existence is eternal and it continues, then it makes the Atma's existence as dependent. It is Atma would have become neither independent nor non-dual. Atma would be always seconded by, is always associated with the world. Just like the Sankhyas, Atma is associated with the Prakriti. Prakriti and Atma both would be parallelly existing. If the Brahman has to be independent and free and samsara rahita, he has to be totally independent. He has to be unconnected with the world. Then is he really unconnected with the world and Atma is independent? This is the question. For the Atma to be existing independently, then the world should not exist independent of Atma. There is no world other than the Atman. Atman itself is called by another name as world. That's all. Look at it in a given angle. But otherwise world itself doesn't exist apart from the Atman. Then only you can see the Atma is Advitiyam and Atma is Nitya Mukta, Atma is free. If the world was parallelly existing to the Atma, that means even if I don't experience the waking world, still the waking, that means I am in dream, I am in deep sleep, still the world exists. If the world were to exist, then there is a waking and deep sleep, both are simultaneously existing as parallels. Waking state is existing one side, deep sleep existing is another side. This would be the problem. So there will be a parallel existence of the world and Atma. So what, really, let it be. Sankhya says, yes, that's what we mean. This is the truth. You only have to detach from the world. You don't have to remove the existence of the world, nor it is possible. You cannot remove the existence of the world. You can only remain detached from the world. That's what Sankhya say. If you can only be detached, and if you can't remove the existence of the world, then you are stuck with Dvaitam. That means, Dvaitam means what? You are limited. You become limited by the world. The world's existence leaves only a part of existence to the Atma. If the world is existing, if world has an existence, then it can't, then Atma cannot claim the whole existence to itself. Atma cannot claim to be the all-round existence, all existence and whole existence. See, Atma is Atma would not become the whole existence. Atma becomes only partial existence by sharing an existence with Prakriti. Atma would have become the sole existence, the complete non-dual, the sole existence. Because somebody else is sharing Atma's existing and somebody else is also existing equal. Sharing means what? Parallel. Sharing means there is no sharing. Actually, sharing means Anatma, the Prakriti, would be existing parallel to Atma. Then the Atma's existence doesn't become independent, complete, non-dual and free. He has to adjust with others. Others means Prakriti. Atma has to adjust to the Prakriti. It has to be nice with the Prakriti. Prakriti controls. Prakriti doesn't leave the total freedom to Atma, because Prakriti comes and interferes in the existence, shares an existence. I am also equal to you. There is an equality, democratic equality. I also exist equal to you. You have to care and consider my existence. Otherwise what happens? I shall limit you. I'll limit your existence. If you share with the Anatma, Anatma will limit your existence. Then you won't become totally free. But Shastra says Atma is free. Atma is Sarvabandha Rahita, Nitya Mukta. If Atma by its very nature is eternally free, then the one which limits the Atma cannot exist really. See this point, let me repeat this last sentence. If Atma is independent, the world cannot exist. If the world exists, it would limit the existence of Atma, then Atma cannot claim to be independent and free and happy. Atma would always be bound by a parallel existence of somebody else. Somebody else also exists equal to me. Dvaitadhi bhayam bhavati. When there is a second one, Atma has a fear. Atma can't be totally fearless. Because the second is always kadutta iruttade, it's always pressurizing, complaining, creating problems to tension to you. Therefore, Upanishad says that Atma is Svatantra, Nitya, Mukta and free and non-dual. If that we have to discover, then we have to understand what is preventing Atma from being non-dual and pure existence. It is in its intrinsic nature, non-dual, pure. But now it appears to be limited because I see Anatma also equally, parallelly existing with Atma. So the second thing, other than the Atma, cannot exist because it is also the Atma alone. Anatma is also Atma. Only due to misunderstanding you see Anatma is another. So that another one, second to Atma, is it a substance or is it only a thought? If it is simply thought, you can correct it by knowledge. Isn't it? That there is a world other than Brahman, that there is something other than Brahman, anything other than the Brahman. If it exists, then Brahman becomes limited. To avoid the limitation, he has to avoid the entire world and discover Atma is independent and non-dual. Okay. Oh. So Atmas. Now the Purapakshi is taking Anatma as something material, something substantial. It may not be independently existing like Nayayika Sankhyas. The Mula Vidya Vadin Advaitins are not exactly like Sankhyas. Sankhyas say Prakriti is totally independent. Prakriti is totally independent, parallel to Atma. Prakriti is existing as much as Atma is existing. As real as Atma is, as real as the Atma, so real is Prakriti. So Prakriti is a joint existence with the Atma. Atma cannot debunk, Atma cannot dismiss the existence of Anatma and claim all alone. Atma cannot claim to be all alone by dismissing Anatma, because Sankhyas can't do, yogis can't do. They only have to adjust with Anatma. They can't dismiss Anatma and stand by themselves non-dual. Only Advaitins say Anatma is just non-existent. It is an another name for the Atma. That means Atma alone is. It is a revolutionary idea and a great idea. So Sankhyas accept Anatma to be Prakriti, to be a parallelly existing, really existing. But Mula Vidyavadins don't accept Anatma as really existing as the Sankhyas say. They differ from Sankhya. Their teaching is definitely improvement over Sankhya. The defects of Sankhya cannot be applied to them. The accusations which we make against Sankhya don't apply to Advaita, even to Mula Vidyavadins. The Prakriti or Anatma. The Prakriti or Anatma, unlike Sankhyas, it is dependent on Atma. It has no independent existence, but it is dependent on Atma. Even the dependency makes something more than Atma. See, if there is something second, how is the second? If the second is not a parallel existence, at least it is a dependent existence. It is a smaller existence. It is a dependent existence on Atma, but still it exists. Therefore, you can't establish non-duality. for the non-duality, Adhyasa is the only one. See, whichever the Vedanta book, whoever is the Vedantic teacher, doesn't talk of Adhyasa, it is not Vedanta at all. It is not Advaita Vedanta at all. There are certain books attributed to Shankara. I tell you, Tattva Bodha is one such a book, which doesn't talk of Adhyasa at all. And still they say this is an Advaita book, the best book, preliminary book, and written by none other than Shankaracharya. But Tattva Bodha doesn't talk of Adhyasa. If there is no Adhyasa, then what kind of world is it? What kind of Vedanta it is? There is no Vedanta. All Vedanta consists in understanding this Anatma as Adhyasta. Anything other than Atma is a Kalpita. If Kalpita is understood as a Kalpita, you stand as an Advaita. Okay. So we need to retain Vedanta. Sankhyas say Prakriti is really independent, whereas Mula Vidya Vadins, though Advaitins, though Vedantins, they also say Brahman alone is Satyam, but they put two tier Satyam. Okay? Mula Vidya Vadins create two. Now, what is the difference between Sankhya on one side and the Shankara Vedanta on another side? Mula Vidya Vadins are in between Sankhyas and also Shankara Vedantins. Shankara Vedantins accept Anatma is nothing but Adhyasta. What is Adhyasta is only a thought of being different. Snake is only a thought about the rope. Note this point. You have no thought of snake. Don't think that we entertain a thought of a snake. I underline it. I repeat it. Note this. Watch this. There is no thought of snake. There is no misunderstanding. There is no pratiti of the snake. In fact, there is only a thought about rope as a snake. Okay? See the difference. There is no thought of snake. Because snake itself doesn't exist, how can you have a thought about the snake? Can you have a thought about the snake? This is a good question. In fact, Swamiji put this question. Panditas were unable to answer, they only abused it instead of answering. When Swamiji put a question, can you have a knowledge about the world? Can you have a knowledge about the world? Can you have a knowledge about the snake? It's an interesting question. If you can answer this question, your Vedantic understanding is clean and correct, perfectly correct. Entire Vedanta is understood in this one statement. Is there a world? Can you have a knowledge of the world? People say, yes, why not? We have a knowledge of the world. Oh, you're not able to understand. There is no knowledge of the world. It is only knowledge about Brahman as the world. World is not an object of knowledge. Note it again. World is not an object of knowledge. World is only a form of knowledge, a form of wrong knowledge about Brahman. Okay? The world is only a form of knowledge, not an object of knowledge. And what form of knowledge? It is a wrong form of knowledge. About whom? About Brahman. This is the most important thing. This is what is a Shankara Vedanta. You don't get these things in Mula Vidya Prakriya. What is the Shankara speciality? This is Shankara speciality. And in one stroke you understand everything as Brahman. Okay. Therefore, there is no knowledge of the snake. There is no bhranti about the snake. Okay. There is no bhranti about the snake. Snake itself is a bhranti about rope. Bhranti jnanam. Bhranti is only jnanam. Bhranti is not vastu. Okay? Bhranti is an experience. Bhranti is a knowledge, a wrong knowledge, a false knowledge. That's all. So, bhranti doesn't have bhranti vishaya. Bhranti is only a knowledge, wrong knowledge. Wrong knowledge doesn't have a wrong object. This is the biggest mistake, the foundation of Mula Vidya. People say, oh, how can you say Mula Vidya is not there? Mula Vidya is not there. They say Mula Vidya, Mula Vidya, Mula Vidya. Oh, Sachidananda Swamiji refutes Mula Vidya. He wrote a book on Mula Vidya Nirasa. Oh my God, they are angry. How can you write a book? What is Mula Vidya? They accept Mula Vidya and they don't know what is Mula Vidya. Mula Vidya Vadins, the peculiar problem of them is they only believe Mula Vidya and they only again they don't know what is Mula Vidya. That's a strange thing. So here Shankara Vedanta says, Sureshwara says, Sachidananda Swamiji says, Shankara Bhashya says, Gaudapada say, Gaudapadacharya say, what does he say? That world is not an object. Since it is not an object, you cannot have knowledge about the world. Note it. About. Underline about it. You cannot have knowledge about the world. Then what? World is only a form of knowledge, not an object of knowledge. A form of knowledge about the rope, about Brahman. World is only a form of knowledge about Brahman. This is Shankara Vedanta. They ask, where does Swamiji differ? They say, Sachidananda Swamiji differs, where is it? This is the point. This is the crux. This is the essential point of Shankara Vedanta. So, you cannot have knowledge about the snake. Can you have an ignorance of the snake? Neither you can have ignorance about the snake, nor you can have knowledge about the snake, because snake itself is a form of ignorance about the rope. A form of misunderstanding about the rope. When the snake itself is a form of misunderstanding, you cannot have ajnanam about snake. You cannot have misunderstanding about snake. Snake itself is a misunderstanding about the rope. Okay? Note this point. Snake itself is a form of misunderstanding about Bombay. I mean about rope. Ambe means I mean Adhara. Snake itself is a form of knowledge, wrong form of knowledge. If you say these things, if you take this prakriya, then this is perfectly Shankara, perfectly Upanishad, and then you get knowledge instantly. Otherwise, if you say world is an object about which I know, I have a knowledge, or about which I have a knowledge, I have ignorance, I have something, then you are treating world as a something substantial. You are taking world as an existence, and that existence will not go in any way. Therefore, they always say world exists for jnani, world exists for ajnani, world exists, 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 world exists for Ishvara, world exists even for Brahma. Somebody told world exists even for Brahma. There was one famous Swami, popular Swami in Bangalore. He passed away recently. He tells the same thing. World exists along with Brahma, and that is Advaita. And he says he is the only one knows Advaita, and he abuses Sachidananda Swamiji, saying that the world doesn't exist at all. Without, there is only Brahma and no world exists. We have got such Advaitins who talks nothing but ignorance, who talk about nothing but ignorance. They teach only ignorance and call it Advaita. And people are also such that, Abba, people have no brains at all. Yes, to Helidharu, just they incapable of understanding. They believe such nonsensical Vedanta as a Vedanta. Asampradayavet murkhavadeva upekshaniyaha. This is what Shankaracharya told. A person who doesn't know the sampradayic teaching, who has not received sampradayic teaching, he should be dismissed as a upekshaniyaha, murkhavat. But the 20th century is producing Vedantins, two types of Vedantins. Having two characters, special character. One is self-studied Vedantins. They read books on their own. They don't study from a guru. self-studied. Second thing is, they say they will discover Brahma by experimenting. I don't know who started this experiment method. One person I know is Gandhi. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. This Mohandas Gandhiji experimented. Then everybody started. Once the printing press, all Vedanta books are started, printed, then this problem has started. Earlier people would study Vedanta from Guru. Books were not important. Nobody would study Vedantic books on their own. They had to study from Guru. Nowadays, every fellow wants to read. In fact, they go to a Guru and ask Guruji, what book should I read? See, you go to Guru, the purpose of Guru is to recommend a book, not to teach. They want to ignore the teaching of Guru. They think that Guru is unnecessary, unimportant. Only the Guru is useful only for recommending a book. Oh, what a dangerous trend, see. Dangerous means ahankara, that's all. A misunderstanding. So they want to self-study. They want to understand Vedanta through reading books. Second thing is, they want to experiment Vedanta. By experimenting you discover. With this, both these things are diseases of 20th century, contributed by Mahatmas only, sadhus only. This is the biggest mistake in understanding Vedanta. And so Mula Vidya Vadins are in between Shankara Vedanta and Sankhya. They say there is a knowledge about the world. World is an object, and you have a knowledge about the world. Snake is an object, and you have a knowledge about the snake. So every wrong knowledge requires a wrong object corresponding to it. What is this wrong object? Is a peculiar, strange object. It is not independent of Brahman, but it is at the same time not non-existent. It exists a kind of existence. It enjoys a kind of existence, not equal to Brahman, but little less than Brahman. It exists a little less than Brahman, depends on Brahman, because this is the problem. World doesn't enjoy any lesser degree. World itself doesn't exist apart from Brahman. This is Vedanta. How? How can you say world doesn't exist apart from Brahman? In one sentence, world is only a thought. And thought doesn't exist apart from consciousness. In the consciousness, there is no thought and no world. Okay? This is the direct understanding. So the Poshankarites, that is the Mula Vidya Vadins, they made Jagat into an object of knowledge. A misunderstanding requires a misobject, a wrong object. Wrong knowledge requires a wrong object along simultaneously as a parallel to it. And this does it. So when you say knowledge is about object. See, if your knowledge, simple example, take the worldly example alone. You have a knowledge of snake. If your knowledge of the snake is concentrated, is centered on snake, then you will remain only in Brahma. But the Vedanta, Shankara Vedanta says, your knowledge of snake is dependent upon rope. There is no snake. Snake is only a form of knowledge. Snake is only a form of knowledge. Jnanada akara, about rope, rajju vishayakaha, jnanakara eva, sarpaha. Sarpa is only a jnanakara, a form of jnana, a wrong jnana, about rajju, about the rope. Once your attention is focused on rope, what you understand is only a wrong understanding about rope. Then your attention is towards the rope, not towards the snake. Okay. But Mula Vidya Vadin's teaching the prakriya diverts your attention to the object snake, corresponding to the snake thought, then the real rope gets ignored. That becomes the problem. This is the defect in post-Shankarites. This is the biggest defect, the foundational defect, which has thoroughly weakened Vedanta, thoroughly weakened the depth of Vedanta, the strength of Vedanta. Its capacity to liberate people has become too weak because of this wrong prakriya. Prakriya means wrong thinking, wrong angle of looking. So, Shankara Vedanta, snake is only a form of knowledge about rope. This is the difference. Most important difference, fundamental difference. Swamiji somehow discovered in Bhashya that the Bhashyakara means only this. Snake is only a form of knowledge about rope. A wrong knowledge, of course. But snake itself as a padartha doesn't exist. Okay. Similarly, the whole entire world, this body, mind and sense organs and the world and time and space, all that I am seeing is only a form of knowledge, a wrong form of knowledge about Brahman. Turn your attention to Brahman. There is no wrong knowledge at all. Wrong knowledge is a wrong. Wrong knowledge, what is wrong knowledge? You look from a wrong angle and it appears to be so. A wrong angle of looking is the cause of wrong knowledge. Otherwise, there is no such thing called wrong knowledge. You are only looking from a wrong angle. And you see something else when you look wrongly and you understand wrongly. Similarly, Purapakshi's mistake is taking snake as an object of wrong knowledge. They say wrong knowledge, wrong object. They go together. And they say this is mithya, this is adhyasa. They have killed the very idea of adhyasa. They have killed the very idea of bhranti. They have killed by misinterpreting, by misunderstanding and misinterpreting, stubbornly defending it, has created adhyasa into a substantial thing. Adhyasa is something substantial. So this is where we need to correct. Okay. We'll stop with today. I'm feeling very tired. We'll continue in the next class. Okay. But anyway, the basic essential point, if you understand, then the whole entire Sugama is only this alone elaborating. If you understand this essential point, if you see that the snake is only a form of knowledge, your attention will be turned towards rope. It's a wrong knowledge. Wrong knowledge means what? The same rope you are looking wrongly. The wrongness of the observation, the wrongness of outlook is corrected by shifting to rope. Shifting means shifting your angle of looking, your way of looking. Shift from the rope. From the rope standpoint, snake doesn't exist at all. All the snakes disappear in the rope. There is only one rope. Okay. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om Tat Sat.